everyone. So today I'm here to share my knowledge on the topic of swagger. So first of all, the agenda, today's agenda will be what is swagger and why we should use swagger, what are the different components of swagger, what are the different data types that we can use, and how we can generate the swagger spec. You can say that this is basically the heart of swagger. So moving on to the next, getting started with play swagger, then what are the important attributes that we use while generating any UI, and the next is swagger code gen, and the last one, generating SDKs via swagger code gen. So first of all, what is swagger? So most of you might be knowing a bit about it, like it is basically, it provides you an interface for your REST endpoints. So from basically the UI of the swagger, what you can understand is what are the different inputs that you need to give, what are the different data types of that inputs, and what would be the response format, and you can easily try your REST APIs without having much knowledge about the implementation logic about any REST endpoint. So you can think of it like an interface, and it can be served as a documentation as well. So why we would be using swagger? So first of all, it is very easy to learn for anyone who is not having much information about the implementation. So you can just try out the API and you can get to know about what the route actually does and what will be the response that you will be getting from it. So the next point is, it generates SDK code. So like for any API, if you do not want someone to give your API code, so what you can do is you can generate the SDKs. So what will they have is, they will have something of kind, a route to hit to get the response, and they would be knowing the response format through the Swagger UI. So you don't need to actually give them the entire logic. So the next point is, I'll be using here play swagger. So what it does is, it can auto generate your swagger spec. So you do not need to actually have much information about how you can write about the swagger spec file. And the last one is, it has a very strong community and very helpful contributors. So discussing about the swagger components, so it has basically four components. The first one is swagger spec, the next one is swagger editor, then the swagger UI, and the fourth one is swagger code gen. So discussing about swagger spec, it is basically the official schema about name, element nesting, orders, and etc. So what it actually contains, it actually contains the attributes like what are the parameters you are passing to the API, and what would be the response format, what would be the response status code, and what are the descriptions, so sort of such things which will be defining your API. The next one is Swagger Editor. Why do we use Swagger Editor is basically just to validate the Swagger spec generated file, whether it is correct or incorrect. So it parses the Swagger spec, and if there are some errors, so it just responds to that yes, there is some error at so and so line. So here we can have a sample of the Swagger editor. So if you are a newbie to Swagger thing, and if you want to validate whether whatever Swagger spec you have written, is it correct or not, so you can try it out on this online Swagger editor. You can pass out your, it actually accepts two formats. The first one is JSON and the next one is YAML. So any one of the two can be accepted, and here it will display any of the errors. So in case if I make some mistakes here, so it will show me yes, there is some error, some syntax error. So, talking about Swagger UI, so it is basically a web page you will see about your REST API having the documentation thing. And the next one is Swagger CodeGen. Swagger CodeGen is basically it accepts your Swagger spec file, and reading that Swagger spec file, it generates your SDK code, which you can give to any of your clients to use your API. So in turn, that generated SDK will hit your API and will get the results from that API, and you can have it on the generated SDKs. And it can be in any of the language, like you can have Java, JavaScript, Scala, Python. So any of the language, there is multi-language support here. So discussing about the data types that you can have. So these are the basic data types which we generally use, like integer, long, float, double, string, byte, binary, boolean, date time and password. So for all of these, what attributes you will be needing is the type and the format. So for the primitive types, the format thing is optional. You can use it or you can avoid it, but you will have to specify the type thing. So now moving on to
so all these data types are seem to be of data type of Java.
Yes.
What about the data types of other languages like Python?
So it supports Scala as well. So there are some of the listing I have already made here, but most of the data types are from Scala as well, like integer, long, float, double. So all of these you can use in Scala as well.
That is fine, but what about the data types which are in Python but not in Scala?
I need to check about Python. So can I move to the next slide? So generating the Swagger spec. So basically there are two techniques. First is using annotations that some of you might have done. And the second one is using iHeart's Play Swagger, which I will be discussing. So the Play Swagger is basically, it is a library that generates Swagger spec from the routes and the case class. Reading it from the routes and the case classes, it generates that Swagger spec file automatically. So getting started with Play Swagger, the steps that you need to do is, the first of all you need to add the dependency for iHeart Play Swagger. The second one is you will have to define a basic swagger.json file or swagger.yml file, and you will have to include it into the conf folder in the Play application. So,
Play Swagger only for Play application?
Yes, it is for Play.
Plugin?
So this is the basic swagger.json file. So you will have to define the version of the Swagger, what will be the host at which your Play application is running, what format it consumes and what format it produces. Like what format it consumes, like what input you can provide to it and what output you are expecting from that. So this is basically basic swagger.yml file. So this will serve for all of the routes that are there in your API. If you want something else to be if you want any specific route to consume something else or produce something else, you can specify it inside the route file. I'll be discussing about it, how you can do it. So the next thing is we have to include another dependency for Swagger UI WebJar, and another one is you will have to include these two routes. So these two routes is, the first one is it is actually responsible for generating your spec file automatically. So it will be basically dependent on the first dependency that I have shown you about the Play Swagger. So it will be using methods from that, and the second one is to render your Swagger UI. So what it the second out, you can see that it is accepting a file here. So this file will be what will be generated from the first out. Is it clear? So the last step is to actually define your controller method, which will be responsible for generating your spec file. So this is my controller, which is having a method called specs. So it will be using this method. Here we are defining the domain package. Domain package is the package where I will be putting my case classes. You can have multiple domain packages, and this domain package has to be passed as parameter to Swagger spec generator. This is a case class which is defined in the play Swagger files. So what it does is so first of all, without going to that point, I will be discussing about the generate method. So generate method is basically responsible for generating your Swagger spec file, and this is defined, this will be called from that instance when it will be actually creating it. So here you can specify the path of the route file. Initially it was not configurable, but before some days this functionality is added that you can have your route file, you can specify the path of your route file. If it is at any other location than the conf folder, by default it takes conf routes. Now moving on to Swagger spec generator, it is accepting the domain package. So here you can have multiple packages. If you have case classes in a single package, then this is fine. Or if you want to pass any other packages, so it actually accepts namespace star. So you can pass multiple packages to Swagger spec generator. So now if you want to see the UI, I have prepared a demo project for the same. So this is how your Swagger UI looks like. Now I will be discussing about the attributes and other things. So after doing all of the 5 steps, if you want to see your UI, so you can go through this link. So this is the localhost 9000 which you have specified in the swagger.json file or swagger.yml file. The next one is swagger.json. So this is the path which I have given in the first one. So it is actually accepting the file which is generated from the api.specs, the controller that I have defined here, the controller method, and from here you get the file and it will be displayed via this link. So you can say localhost 9000, then there come docs. So docs is this one. So discussing about the tags and the attributes that we can use here is, the first one is tag. So it is used to group your routes into one thing. Like if you have some payment related routes, so you can group all of the routes into one thing. Like if you want to payment initiate, payment view, so all of these can be grouped into one. So these are the basically tags that I have used. So body data, when you will click on it, all of the routes that you want to categorize into one thing will appear here. So there is only one that I have made for the demo. You can have multiple routes. So if the tag is body data, so all of those routes will come inside this body data tag. So similarly, path contain data, query string contain data. Uh, Moving on to the next step, summary. So it is used to define what your route is actually doing. A short summary, 2 to 3 word description. So here you can see that there is mirror response written. So this is actually what you specify in the summary tab. The next one is consumes and produces. This is what I discussed about. Like if you want to have something extra, then what is specified in the swagger.json file, you can specify it in consumes and produces. The next tag is, the attribute is parameters. Parameters is a tag inside which you can define all of the inputs that you want your API to have. So
consumes, example like file upload.
Consumes is like it can be it can be text, it can be JSON, or it can be form URL encoded body, or it can be multi-part form data. So the parameters. To view it on the UI, so this is how your parameters will look like. So what you can define inside your parameter is what is the name of your parameter, what are the type it accepts. So the data type slide I have shown you. The next is you can specify the description about any particular input element. And the data type you can mention here. It is always visible. So it is basically working as a point where you can hit your API, plus it is working, it is serving as a documentation as well. So the next one is responses. So responses is basically what it takes is, in responses tab you can specify what are the different response codes, and according to those response codes you can specify the schema of any response. Like it can be an error response, it can be like it can have a different structure if the case is success, or if the case is if there are any other cases. So you can specify it, but yes, for one response code you can have only one schema. The next one is schema. So schema is what here you can actually point to your case classes, the response case classes that you have created. As I told before that it works, how it generates the swagger spec is it reads from your route file and it reads from your case classes. So case classes here serves as the response format. The next one is description. Description you can have for the input elements, you can have it for a particular route as well. The next one is required. So this is for basically applying validation for the Swagger UI. For any route you can specify any input to be required or non required. The default value is always false. So now there can be a case that your route file has a lot of things. There are a lot of routes, but you do not want every route to be displayed on the Swagger UI. So you can hide any of the endpoint by specifying no docs over the route. So now moving on to the technical things, how you can specify query parameters. So we are actually defining this structure, we will have to specify somewhere that yes, this is my route and this is accepting my these inputs and these response formats and these are the response codes. So here is where you are actually defining. In the routes file, above every route you will have to specify the structures. So first one is tags, which I have shown you in the UI thing. So you can specify it like this. Then the summary, that comes on the side part. Then the parameters. So parameters is basically an array, so you can have multiple parameters. So here I am using just one input, that is ID, and it is a query parameter, so I am specifying it here in query here. And the description is student ID, and this field is required. So I'll have to specify required to be true. And what is the type of this parameter? It is string. So the response that I am expecting from here is 200 response code, and the description is success, and the schema would be student record response. So this is one of my case class which resides in my model package. So as you could have seen in my controller file, here I have specified my domain package to be models. So from here I am referring my case classes. So this is about in query parameter. Moving to in path parameter. So this is one of my route, and it is accepting ID in path. So what is the difference between the first one, in query and in path? It is just this one. So here it was in query for query parameter, and in this it is in path for to pass a parameter in path. Yes, I will be discussing about it. Like for here, for the demo purpose, I have taken here only one response code. So you can have a default response code here, and you can specify the response structure. In case if the response codes, there can be multiple response codes, but if none of those matches, then you always move to the default one. The next one is specifying parameters as form URL encoded body. So the difference here lies in the consumes part. Here I am specifying it as form URL encoded body. And in, I am specifying as form data. So the next one is sending multi-part form data. So again, the difference lies only here. Consumes is multi-part form data, and in form data. So if you talk about multi-part and form URL encoded body, the difference lies only here. So it is multi-part form data here, and application form URL encoded here. So now actually this is one of the problem that we face in our project. So what happens is we generally consider our JSON response into snake case, and we create our case classes in camel case format. So what if I want to show it as it is on my UI? So if I am using my case class format as the response, so it will always appear as in the camel case format in the UI as well. Like so here actually these are there is an example for this. So basically these are just single words, so it won't be very clear from here. So if I would make it as student contact, so if I am using my case class format and as per Scala conventions of case classes, so it will always appear as in the camel case format. But what if my response code is in like student underscore contact in the snake case? Then what you need to do is you will have to override the definitions by using this technique. So this is one of the examples. So what you will have to define is intern record response. First of all, we were doing it using case class thing. So for this thing, we were making the case class. But now if we want to override it, we will have to define the definition stack inside the basic swagger.json file we have created. So inside that, we will have to provide this thing. And this is my response structure. So what is the type? It is of type object. Why object? Because inside data it is having another thing, so I'll have to specify such kind of structure where there is data and inside data I have some intern ID and intern email. So then I'll have to specify intern record, which in turn will be having these things. So these things can be defined inside the property and we will have to specify the type. So now the answer of your question lies here. So these are the response details. So inside the response tab, you can specify it as per the response codes, like if it is 200, if it is 400, and if the response is none of these, then this is my response structure or response format. So here it is defining like definitions mein, it is models.request with body. So it is again referring to my case class, which is inside my models package. For the next one is for 400. You can see like we can provide different description for each of the response codes. So now this is something that I found missing on the Swagger UI part. So when you here in my this response format, it is showing contact as, I mean, for any integer thing it actually displays it like this. But if you want to see the correct schema, you can move to this tab and you can have the exact definitions here. So here you can see that yes, this is optional, but when you look in this model schema, you cannot find it here. So this thing is still left to be done. So now moving on to Swagger CodeGen. So Swagger CodeGen is basically it is responsible for generating the SDKs for my API, and you can have your SDKs generated in any of the language, irrespective of in whatever language your API is written. So like if your API is written in Scala, you can have your SDK generated in Java, you can have it in PHP or any other language, which is obviously compatible to be converted into. So now for generating the SDK, these are the steps you will have to actually clone the project, Swagger CodeGen. Now moving on to the project, you will have to first build the project. And then you can generate your SDK using this command. So this is basically it is using the Swagger CodeGen client jar. Now it is using your swagger.json, which is actually your generated Swagger spec. So this path you can get from here. So you can see this is the path. If you would like to see what is actually there, this is my Swagger spec, which is generated via the controller method that we have created, which is using the play Swagger. So these are the definitions which are generated. So next, minus L is for specifying in which language you want your SDK to be generated, and then minus O flag is used to specify where you want to store your generated SDK. So this is all about Swagger UI and Swagger CodeGen. I would like to tell one more thing. Like when I told you about when we were actually overriding the definitions thing, when we do not want to use the case class, but I want to specify a different format, which I discussed about the camel case and snake case thing, the problem. So there is just one difference, like inside for case classes, you were specifying inside definitions, then the model name, and then the case class. So here what you need to do is, inside definitions, you can directly specify this response. Because we have overridden it, and it is already present inside the swagger.json file. So you do not need to move to any other thing.
So from this file, it's a JSON file, right?
Yes.
Swagger.json file. From here, what we can see is that we are having few form elements, right? How these form elements comply with the case classes that we have created?
So this is what I told you, like here we are not using the case class thing. If I want, like I discussed one problem, in case classes we always use camel case format as per Scala convention. But if I want to specify in my UI in the form of snake case, so what I will have to do, because it is serving as my documentation as well, so I cannot specify in my documentation like I am like intern ID in my documentation and intern ID in my response structure and intern ID as camel case in my actual project. So I cannot portray it like that. So for solving that problem, what we have done is I have overridden the definition. So here I am not using that case class.
So that is fine. But in generally in play, we create form case classes, like case class is just for the forms that we write. So does it like check at the compiler or at any like runtime whether this intern ID is of type long or string or not?
No. This is just for the purpose. I mean, this is just for the documentation purpose. Plus, this is used while you are generating your SDK. So, as I told you that this the Swagger file which is generated is actually passed as input while you are generating your SDKs here. So you need to have the correct definitions here so that the correct SDK is generated.
So if the JSON file says that okay, intern ID is integer, but in the code we have the string,
okay,
will it work for each?
For that, we can define the data types over there. So can you show the Swagger UI?
Yeah.
So this is fine, but here I can see that it's string.
It's string.
What I have coded in my Java Scala code, it doesn't integer. But
we can specify it. We can specify it as int.
That part is we are handling in our controller side, that it will likely go into the form with error case.
So does it like generate those errors in the compiler? That is, if swagger.json file says something else, but the code is
so you don't have the data at the compile time. Eventually you won't be having name or ID at compile time. Okay, so that's like an empty box.
But I do know the data type. I don't know the data, but I know the type.
Okay,
it will be an integer or a string.
Okay,
so it should tell me the error now. If I'm generating a documentation or an SDK for that,
okay,
then it should comply with code. That okay, you cannot provide a string for integer or a vice versa.
This thing is not It is actually generated when you are hitting the route I specified for generating the UI, and on runtime it generates its swagger spec. So it is not actually validating it with the code that whether these two things are in compliance with each other or not.
So you mean if we are changing in our JS classes, then we have to make corresponding changes in our UI?
Yes, you will have to do that.
Is swagger.json
is auto-generated, but it is as per the routes and the case class definitions. So if what benefit you can get from here is, if you are using the case classes inside your code, you can use the same case classes or the same response case classes in your swagger UI view. So if you are making any changes into that, so it will directly be reflected in UI view. But if you are using another case classes which you are not using inside your code, so then you will have to make changes.
And it can be used for any other API or server-side, like not just for Play.
Yeah. So here I have used Play Swagger, so it is specifically for Play. But for any other, like there are another methods too for creating this Swagger UI thing. So here I have discussed it only about Play.
Yeah, so you can use the annotation part, the other part.
Yeah.
For that purpose, you can use the annotation part.
Annotations look more like Java or not.
Actually, annotations में क्या होता है कि ना, you need to specify all the documentation on controller itself. So जहाँ से controller start होता है, उसके ऊपर आपको सारा पूरा गन बनाना होता है. So the place swagger, what it gives you, you don't need to specify anything on the controller side, just specify it on the route file. So like all the messy thing will be on only one file, which will be of route.
But there is a documentation that
there. In that case, we are not really putting all the annotation part above the controller, the path that we define in our HTTP. We are not doing that. Maybe we are just creating a separate file that is a doc file, and you can just put in there. So it's a separate file. You can actually make the annotation part separate from the controller.
So this is basically
that can be extra thing.
It is just an alternative to that annotations method.
I don't know what I think Bharat is saying, that he's saying that annotations, if you use the cache HTTP, then you have to use annotations.
Mm-hmm. But if you can make sure
that, then you have to use the route file.
Yes.
So that is just
actually we couldn't find anything to implement Swagger in our Play project. We had the Play project and we had to implement the Swagger thing.
So actually it was pretty easy. That's why we gone for Play Swagger.
If you have routes,
you can just define any. It's your choice. You want to use Core Swagger, you can go for the annotation methods and
if you have a service that has the controller part and it is not residing within your Play project, then you need to write the talk outside the thing.
Of course.
And so we can generate SDK for any language. But can we use Swagger with any language? Like can we use it with Python itself or any other language?
I have not done so research on it. I'll have to check it out. So now moving on to the demo. So I have created as per the examples, like if the data is in body and if I am extracting it if it is in the query string or if it is in the path. So this is one of my route. What it does is, what it takes, it returns it back. It is actually doing mirror response. So what it takes from the input, it displays the same. So here I can specify any name, any ID. So from here, I can try out my route. So here is the response, and this is my response code. So this is one of the case, one of the success case. So if I will provide here something else, so here you can see the response as per the inputs, and you can specify if there is any incorrect input, or this is just for the sake of displaying that yes, you can have different responses formats. So like if there is problem in parsing input JSON, then you can have this form of structure, and any if there is any other case, you can have this form of structure. So now to see if it is there in the path, you are actually extracting a student record by the ID you provide. So if I provide it to here and try out, so yes, there is record is existing and I get the response. If I specify here like any another ID which is non-existing, so it displays me the error, yes, that no record found for the given ID, and this is specified here as well. So it is serving as the documentation, plus you can try out your routes. So these are just the examples I have shown you in the slides. So for body, for path, and for queries. Any other questions? So I have put my project, the demo project, in my GitHub account. So if you face any problem, you can refer it from me. Any other questions?